I say, God is an awesome God. And I'm excited about the move of God. Everything that you do for God, give it 100%. Why not? Because anything less you give into the devil. Everything that you do for God, give it 100%. If I'm singing, give it 100%. If I'm clapping my hands, give it 100%. Let God get the glory and the praise. Somebody say amen. Now, Scott, you're lucky today. I have to be somewhere at 2 o'clock. Amen. Amen. And so I solicit your prayers. Go with me today. First Lady was not feeling well this morning, so she's not able to come out today, but she's going to be all right. Amen. And we celebrate that. St. Matthew chapter number 1. I worship him. Brother Jacob has been doing a great job with our video announcements, but we're going to let him rest for the rest of the year. Amen. And we're just going to flow with the announcements and give them a break. Amen. And just celebrate and have church in Jesus. Matthew chapter number one. I want you to note with me, please, verses 18 through 25. In my devotional time, the Lord has really been speaking to my heart concerning some things. And I would like to share it with you. If you have it, say amen. Let us read in concert. Now the birth of Jesus Christ was on this wise. When his mother Mary was espoused to Joseph, before they came together, she was found child with child of the Holy Ghost. Then Joseph, her husband, being a just man and not willing to make her a public example, was minded to put her away privily. But while he thought on these things, I mean, you just don't just get over these situations like that. Behold, the angel of the Lord appeared unto him in a dream, saying, Joseph, thou son of David, fear not to take unto thee Mary thy wife, for that which is conceived in her is of the Holy Ghost. And she shall bring forth a son, and thou shalt call his name Jesus, for he shall save his people from their sins. Now all this was done that it might be fulfilled which was spoken of the Lord by the prophet, saying, Behold, a virgin shall be with child, and shall bring forth a son, and they shall call his name Emmanuel, which being interpreted is God with us. Then Joseph, being raised from sleep, did as the angel of the Lord had bidden him, and took unto him his wife, and knew her not till she had brought forth her firstborn son, and he called his name Jesus. Father, speak to our hearts and to our minds. We thank you for the opportunity to be able to share your word. I pray, God, indeed it will be all of you and none of me. I ask, God, that you release a prophetic anointing in this house that will cause teaching and preaching to become easy. I pray if there's a soul here, God, that does not know you in a free pardon of sin, let something be said or done that will challenge them in their ways, that they may come running crying, what must I do to be saved? Now, God, you be glorified, the devil be horrified, and people, God, remain sanctified. In Jesus' name, if you love that name, clap your hands one more time. Thank you. God bless you. I want to talk to you from the thought, Lord, help me. Yeah, look at somebody, say, I need the Lord to show enough help me. Let's try it one more time. Lord, help me. Oh, please pray with us here. If you were given the opportunity to meet any person in the so-called Christmas story, who would you choose? It's really not an easy choice. There are a lot of fascinating people. There was one by the name of Herod. You know Herod, that wicked old toad squatting on the throne of Israel, who was insanely jealous lest the baby should steal his glory. Now, insane jealousy is a fixed belief that's firmly entrenched and unshakable. Any counter evidence given does not appease their anger or their suspicion. In other words, there will be no satisfying answer that will release them from this jealousy. When you are insanely jealous, you suspect a familiar person as a potential rival. So Herod now pictures the baby Jesus as a threat to his kingdom. The Song of Solomon, chapter number 8 and verse number 6 says, jealousy is as cruel as the grave. Lord, help me. Would you want to meet the Magi, the wise men from the east? Somebody say, who were they? Where did they come from? Were they astrologers? How did they know about the star? Because when you look at the star, there are approximately 76 trillion stars in the world. Sly and the Family Stone, most of us remember Sly. He said, everybody is a star. But Revelation chapter 22, verse 16 said, but Jesus is the bright and morning star. Oh, what about the innkeeper? See, I can see him in my mind's eye. He's a good man, Herod frustrated to turn away business. Did he ever really know who he really turned away? Matthew 16 and 16, Peter said, thou art the Christ, the Son of the living God. Or what about the shepherds, my brothers and sisters? Here's something you probably don't know. You see, nearly all of the shepherds in modern Israel are teenagers, and many of them are girls. There is every reason to think that the shepherds were not the old men of tradition, but in actuality, teenagers, who were somewhere around the ages of 15 or 16 years old. There are so many others that we could talk about today. There would be Anna, the prophetess, a widow who never left the temple. The scripture teaches us that she was there in continuous fasting, prayer, and worship. She had been married for 7 years, 84 years old now, and she never left the temple. Continue to fast, continue to pray, continue to seek for the face of God. And then there was one by the name of Simeon, who took the baby Jesus in his arms and blessed him as he blessed his parents. And then there is also Mary. Mary, don't you know, this baby boy. Luke wrote about Mary in all of his stories. But there is someone today, my brothers and sisters, that I think that I like to meet even more so. Because this individual is the forgotten man of Christmas. His name is Joseph. Have you ever forgotten? Have you ever wondered, my brothers and sisters, if God has forgotten you? Have you ever felt as if your prayers were just bouncing off the ceiling and hitting you on top of the head? In the book of Genesis, chapter number 8, verse number 1, the scripture gives us three words. God remembered Noah. Those three words, my brothers and sisters, tell us a great deal about the Lord. And one of the greatest human fears is to be forgotten. When the text tells us that God remembered Noah, it doesn't mean that God had forgotten about him. It simply means, my brothers and sisters, that in the midst of storms, in the midst of the flood, that God stayed true to his promise. Just look at somebody and say, God will stay true to his promise. The scripture says that he promised to deliver Noah and his family. The Bible teaches us that the Lord looked down on earth and remembered to have mercy on 8 people who was floating in this large barge. The story contains a particular message, a special message of hope. In the midst of all judgment, God always remembers mercy. He remembers those, my brothers and sisters, who suffer, and he keeps his eyes on them and reminds us he won't put no more upon you than you're able to bear. And though they suffer long and oftentimes feel forgotten, the Almighty God would not abandon them. The scripture also teaches us, and God, or as God remembered Noah, even so would he remember you, and even so would he remember me. Would you put your hands together one more time for Jesus? May I remind you and encourage you, my brothers and sisters, that there is no trial so severe that it can separate us from God, who loves us with an everlasting love. And that's what Christmas message is all about, brothers and sisters. It's about grace and mercy that equals hope, joy to the world. The Lord is come. Joseph, though, in our text, the brothers and sisters, is the forgotten man of Christmas. That's not exaggeration. You see, not much is said, my brothers and sisters, about him in the Bible. Not many sermons are preached about Joseph. As a matter of fact, there's not much written about Joseph at all. If you was to check our hymn, I looked at it in our hymn book, Mary is mentioned about 7 times in what we call the Christmas song. Joseph is not even mentioned, not even once. Joseph's father, brothers and sisters, was a man by the name of Jacob. His family hometown was Bethlehem. Bethlehem in scripture, the old Hebrews used to call it on the way. And it speaks about, if you really want to connect this up with Genesis 3:15, and it speaks about Adam, from Adam to Jesus Christ is 4,000 years. And God is constantly reminding us that he's on the way. Would you just look at somebody and tell them that God is on the way? Come on, clap your hands and give God some praise. The Bible teaches us his hometown was Bethlehem, Judea, but he lived in Nazareth in Galilee. That means, my brothers and sisters, that Joseph and Mary had to travel about 95 miles in the dead winter in order to register for the census. He is from the royal line of David. The genealogy in Matthew makes that particularly clear. He was a carpenter by trade. He was a poor man. And we know that because when he and Mary presented Jesus in the temple, the word of God teaches us that they brought a turtle dove to sacrifice. Note now, because Jews did that when they could not afford to bring a lamb to sacrifice. And yet John the Baptist sees Jesus and said, "Behold the Lamb of God that taketh away the sins of the world." Joseph, brothers and sisters, was a religious man. He was a devout keeper of the law. The scripture then, you might ask me the question, how old then was Joseph? We don't really know the answer for sure. There are some that try to say or suggest that he was 90 years old. There's some that try to suggest he was 45 years old. But most writers agree, and theologians agree, that he was a young man and even that he was probably a teenager. If you said he might have been somewhere around the age of 17 years old, it would probably be just about right. Pledged to be married. Joseph was pledged to be married to Mary. I'm going somewhere. Just hang with me. In those days, most marriages was arranged by the parents and with or without the children's approval. Could you imagine that happening today? That Sister Sims and I will pick out the husbands that we want them to marry? Help us, Lord. Yes. And once the contract was signed, the man and the woman were legally pledged to each other. And this was last up to at least a year. And then at the end of the year, my brothers and sisters, they would be formally married in a public wedding ceremony. Y'all follow me here? Now, the pledge, brothers and sisters, was considered now to be a sacred pledge. It was more than just what I've heard some people say about a marriage license. It's just a piece of paper. If it don't work, you just throw it away. No, this pledge was to be sacred. And during that particular year, the couple were called husband and wife, but they did not live together. If the man died during that year, the scripture teaches us that the woman will be considered to be a widow, even though the wedding ceremony never took place. The only way then, my brothers and sisters, to break the betrothal was through a legal divorce. To be pledged to each other was the same thing then as to being married, going somewhere, except that they could not live together until the wedding ceremony took place. Oh, help me here. Hold on. You're my husband and you're my wife, but we can't stay together until the ceremony took place. Yeah. I remember back in 1971 when Sister Sims and I, we was engaged to be married in November, and it was like October, and I had worked all day long, amen, and had been pouring cement, had been pushing the cement for about 40 yards, and it was dead tired. About 8:30, I called Merle and said, "Listen, I'm not going to make it today, tonight, baby." She said, "Oh, Tommy, I really wanted to go out. Can you just please come over? Just come over." So I go over, she said, and then I'm put up to ask her parents. Now, it's less than a month before we get married, and I'm asking, I said, "Mr. Staples, Merlin, can we go out tonight?" And he looks at me. "I knew you wasn't just coming over here just to visit her." Now I'm saying to myself, "Hold up. We're getting married in about 3 weeks. It's 9 o'clock. He says, "You better have her back by 11 o'clock. Imagine that now, because you are married. You're called husband. You're called a wife. But you can't stay together. You can't sleep together. Y'all follow me here? And now all of a sudden, they're engaged. They have this betrothal. There's a pledge in place. And then Mary turns up pregnant. And Joseph knows one thing for sure: I'm not the father. What words then, my brothers and sisters, describe a man at a time like this? Anger, confusion, frustration, embarrassment, shame, rage, and disappointment. Remember now, because every man has a spirit of instruction. And so, sisters, when your man can't fix a thing, when we can't figure out how to make things work, when we don't have an answer to the problem that we're facing, we get frustrated. We get aggravated because we like to fix things. Y'all follow me here? So then you got to ask yourself, what then is the conversation between Mary and Joseph at this point? Because now remember, here is on this side, here is Joseph who likes to fix things because he operates with a spirit of instruction. But on the other side of the spectrum, here is this woman called Mary, who, and a woman has a spirit of many emotions. So did she tell him about the angel Gabriel? Or did she blame him for not believing her? Did he say, Mary, how could you? You were pledged to me. You're my wife. I kept myself for you. Why couldn't you keep yourself for me? Look at somebody say, let's keep it on the 100 here today. Because y'all know how that's how y'all be acting. Yeah. Yeah, I'm making some of you mad just thinking about it. Help me here, Holy Ghost. But just put yourself, brothers and sisters, put yourself in Joseph's shoes. You're a teenager in love, and suddenly your girl turns up pregnant. Put yourself in Joseph's shoes, but understand what Mary are. And remind yourself, you're not the father, and you don't know who is. And you're madly in love. What do you do? Now, the typical American teenager today would ask for $300 for an abortion. After all, 500,000 take that option every year. It's the preferred solution for what people call an unwanted pregnancy. But Joseph and Mary didn't have that option. Abortion was very rare in ancient Israel, and Planned Parenthood hadn't opened up a clinic in Nazareth yet. So Joseph's dilemma was of a different variety on today. Joseph, he was an observant Jew, and under the law, he had the right to divorce Mary for unfaithfulness. In fact, the law forbade Joseph to marry her under those circumstances. But then here is the greatness of Joseph. On one side, he's hearing what the law says. And because the scripture teaches him as a lover of God, and because he was a just man, as a righteous man, but on the other side, he loved him some Mary. So what was Joseph to do? Is this all right today? The scripture teaches us he loved her even though he thought she had been unfaithful to him. His love carried or covered her shame. He loved her enough that his love will cover her shame. You ought to praise God for loving you enough that the love of Jesus Christ covers your shame. Somebody shout hallelujah to the Lord. May I remind you today, brothers and sisters, you better hurry up, Sims. It hurts to love. It hurts to invest in people. It hurts to be vulnerable. It hurts to be that open. It hurts to be that giving. Love is sacrificial. It's not self-serving. It's not puffed up. It does not behave itself unseemly. It does not seek its own. Love makes us give our coat to someone else and walk home in the cold. The love of Jesus Christ, my brothers and sisters, will restore you. The love of Jesus will fill you, and the love of Jesus will give you his name. Somebody shout hallelujah to the Lord. Come on, clap your hands and shout hallelujah to the Lord. I want to remind you, because Jesus loves you that way, look at somebody, say, he'll open up doors for you. Somebody shout hallelujah to the Lord. And all the credit, my brothers and sisters, should go on to God for what he's doing in the midst of our life. After all, it's his love that makes ways out of no ways for us. Somebody clap your hands one more time. I got to hurry up here. He loves you today, my brothers and sisters, with crazy grace. Even when he smells unfaithfulness in the midst of our heart, he still loves you. I find out that God will love you in jail. He will love you all the way and bring you out of hell. He'll love you through all of your diseases. He loves you while you were cheating with the money. He loves you in spite of all your failures. God still yet loves you. And this, my brothers and sisters, is how Joseph loved Mary. He wouldn't disgrace her. He wouldn't put her in the public eye. In other words, he would say, I'm not putting her up on Facebook simply because my love for her is greater than that. I would not make a public spectacle of her. My love for her is greater than that. Come on, clap them hands and give God some praise. So what Joseph did, my brothers and sisters, was he chose to do it privately by giving her the papers in the presence of two witnesses rather than a humiliation of public divorce. He had every right, my brothers and sisters, to divorce Mary, but he just couldn't divorce Mary that way. He just couldn't do it. So in the midst of waiting, the scripture teaches us that God sent an angel of the Lord. Psalms 27:14 reminds us to just wait upon the Lord. Be of good courage, and he shall strengthen thy heart. He said, wait, I say, upon the Lord. And the Bible says that an angel will become the messenger of God. Now speaks to Joseph in a dream, telling him not to be afraid to take Mary home as your wife. That's all Joseph needed, my brothers and sisters, was just an assuring word from God. I'm not just talking about a man. I'm not just talking about another woman. I'm talking about showing word from God. Because when God said it's all right, it's all right. That God reminded, he said, that which is conceived in her is of the Holy Ghost. In other words, it wasn't Joe Mack, it wasn't real to do. No, this thing that she has, as Luke called it, Luke said it's a holy thing. It's conceived of the Holy Ghost. And that was the assurance, my brothers and sisters, that Joseph needed on today. Can I preach right about now? The Bible says that God then met him at the point of his need and exactly the right moment. I come to remind you today, as we continue to celebrate Jesus Christ, that God will meet you at the point of your need. Somebody shout hallelujah to the Lord. The struggle then, my brothers and sisters, is not to make you bitter, but the struggle is to make you better. God said he's working all things, so it's going to work out for your good. The angel now began to explain to just enough. And just enough simply says it wasn't somebody else. It was the Holy Ghost, Joseph. And then it didn't stop there. He said, this is what I need you to do. He said, I want you to call his name Jesus. That which is conceived is the Holy Ghost. His name is Jesus, which means Jehovah has become salvation. Clap your hands and give God some praise and shout hallelujah to the Lord. I'm going to make it today. So please note now, my brothers and sisters, verses 24 and verse number 25, because they reveal Joseph's finest quality. You see, every step he takes testifies to his greatness. Number one, by marrying her quickly, he broke all of the Jewish customs, but he protected Mary's reputation. She was pregnant, and it wasn't his, but he married her anyway. Somebody shout hallelujah to the Lord. How many just passed you by, but Jesus just took you and married you anyway? Somebody shout hallelujah. Number two, my brothers and sisters, by keeping her a virgin until Jesus was born, he protected the miracle of Jesus' conception by the Holy Spirit against the slander of the unbelievers, against the slanders and the haters, and said, Joseph, that's not your child. You need a divorce. He chose to believe the promise of God rather than to be persuaded by the thought of humanity. Somebody say, yes, Lord. Number three, my brothers and sisters, by naming the baby Jesus, he exercised a father's prerogative, and this officially took him into his family as his own legal son. So Joseph, my brothers and sisters, he strikes me today as a man's man. I wish I had some real men in the house on today. Somebody clap your hands and give God some praise.
and shout hallelujah to the Lord. It's going to get a little tight here for just a minute here. But if you just walk with me, it's going to be all right. What we need is more men in the house of God. What we need is more men to give a voice towards God's word. What we need is more men that's not ashamed of the gospel of Jesus Christ. More men that will stand up for their family. More men that will stand up in the midst of the community. More men that will stand when nobody else will stand and tell them that Jesus Christ is Lord of Lords and He's King of Kings. Somebody clap your hands and give God some praise and shout hallelujah to the Lord. But as we read the text on today, I'm going somewhere. We give more attention to Mary, and that is rightly so. But look at somebody said, but Joseph deserves some credit too. Because Joseph now becomes a model of faith. He's struggling with his own doubts. He's persuaded to believe in what God has said and ultimately acting on his persuasion. Joseph, my brothers and sisters, he looked like he was tough when he could have been weak. He was tender, my brothers and sisters, when he could have been harsh. He was thoughtful, my brothers and sisters, when he could have been hasty. He was trusting, my brothers and sisters, when he could have doubted. He was temperate, my brothers and sisters, when he could have indulged himself. How about you, brothers? Does that really describe your life? Because we think it's the bumping of the shoulders. We think it's the pumps and the high fives. We think it's how we dress and how we look and how we carry ourselves. But you can look buff on the outside, but weak down on the inside. I wish you had a real church here today. Somebody shout hallelujah to the Lord. I want to know today, my brothers, are you tough-minded? Are you determined to do what's right, no matter what it costs? Are you tender with your wife, and are you tender with your children? You don't like me here. Are you thoughtful, taking your time to make decisions? Are you quick to jump to conclusions, and quick to say things that you later regret saying that you ever said it? Are you trusting, my brothers, even when you think you couldn't figure out a better way to do the thing yourself? Are you temperate? Are you considerate of your wife and her special needs? She's more than just a cook. She's more than just somebody to wash your clothes. She is who she is. She's your helper. She is your wife. She is your lover. She is your completion. Y'all don't like me here on the day. And do you pressure your wife? And do you pressure your children to perform up to your standard? In other words, they're doing the very best that they can do, and they're still coming short of your standards. What about you coming up to the standard of God? Y'all don't like me here. You ain't getting no help from the music today. Somebody shout hallelujah to the Lord. And this is one of the line of proof about the kind of man that Joseph was. You see, my brothers and sisters, when Joseph grew up and began to raise Jesus up, he began his ministry. But Jesus now chooses one word. And observe this thing, my brothers and sisters. Out of all the other words to describe what God is like, Jesus called God Father. What did Jesus learn about fathers from a man called Joseph? So I speak again to the men on the way. The way your children respond to God depends largely on the kind of father that you are. Oh, y'all don't like me here today. Yes. And may I remind all of my sisters on today, if that man is not in your child's life, they don't have to be fatherless. Let me be the spiritual father. You have a father in Jesus Christ, in Heart of God Ministry. Somebody shout hallelujah to the Lord. Because we are reaching people with God's love. You teach them something about God every day. Just by the way, my brothers and sisters, that you live in front of them. You wonder what's wrong with your children? Take a self-examination as to how you live before your child. Y'all don't like me here? Somebody shout, Lord, I need you to help me. Up on her dying bed, my precious mother Totten told us, as we said, Mom, you did a good job in raising us. And even though she couldn't open up her eyes, and even though she has suffered a stroke and a heart attack at the same time, up on her dying bed, she said, no. She said, it was the Lord and I that did what we did. Somebody ought to give God some praise and shout hallelujah to the Lord. Look at somebody and say, I couldn't have done it without the Lord. I need in every moment, every second, and every day of my life. Somebody shout hallelujah. I come to tell you, if you want respect, you got to first learn how to respect yourself. And when you respect yourself, you're mindful as to how you present yourself. I remember the book Judge Stevens' brother wrote, when you're in charge, take charge. You're in charge of your life, so take charge. If you want your family to be blessed, make sure you put yourself in position to where you can be blessed. One thing have I desired of the Lord, and that would I seek after, that I may dwell in the presence of the Lord all the days of my life. But let me put an asterisk there, because as my mother stand today, I want to appreciate you for doing the very best you could do to raise your child all by yourself. If it had not been for the Lord who was on your side, you wouldn't be here today. I encourage you to stand up on the promise of God according to Acts 2:39, that not only will God save you, he's going to save your children and your children's children. As I reflect back on my mother Todd, doing the best thing she could go on to glory was with the ideal and the thought in knowing that all 8 of her children were saved, sanctified, and filled with the power of the Holy Ghost. That's the best thing that could ever happen to your child. It's not being a millionaire, because it's only temporary. But the best thing you can see out of your child is to see your child saved. Somebody shout hallelujah to the Lord. See, yes, Lord. The Bible says that the angel of the Lord said, "Thou shalt call his name Jesus." Let me just say something right here. I had to laugh within myself, because about 3 months ago, I remember preaching this sermon, and I wasn't even conscious-minded. This was a sermon that I preached in my dreams. But I remember talking about you shall call his name Jesus. And every time you say Jesus, you said he's my Savior. To say he's my Savior, you say he's my way maker. To say he's my way maker. If you need to be saved, if your sins need to be forgiven, if you need to be washed, if you need a brand new beginning, if you need some joy in your life, if you need some hope in your life, if you need the anointing in your life, if you need some problems fixed in your life, if you need a way made out of no way, it's in the name of Jesus. But in verse number